Okay, so before we jump into the topic of today's video, I'm gonna give you guys a generalized update on all of the aquariums in this room. We'll start at the very end. This is one of two Lake Tanganyika aquariums. It has a combination of fish that are really interesting in behavior. First and foremost, we have some shell dwellers. These guys are quickly becoming some of my favorite fish. But although we've already kept shell dwellers for a number of years, we also have some crevice dwellers, which are these yellow fish. These are lily lupi, or however you want to pronounce that. This tank doesn't have a tremendous amount to update on just yet, but I am thinking of freeing up this tank by moving all of these tiny fish into the other Lake Tanganyika aquarium, which we'll update here in a second. Now I'll get your guys' ideas and thoughts on that in a minute, but we'll see what happens there. And then of course, the Central American aquarium holding some large vieja Cinspilla cichlids. These guys are getting incredibly large. I'd estimate that this female here is probably maybe 6 inches. Then we got this big 8-inch male. Mind you, we're using a wide angle lens, so a lot of my fish and tanks always look much smaller than they actually are. But this guy's a nice boisterous male, looking absolutely incredible. This could also be another male, but we started out with six, and I've slowly had to dwindle the stocking simply due to the males just not putting up with anything else in the tank. This is the only lone female. What I'm thinking of doing, and this might sound cruel, but I can get them to breed potentially if, and this is based on years of my past breeding. I've always found that when I was struggling to breed discus, for example, I knew that if I netted them, put them in a bucket temporarily, moved their aquarium and or started the aquarium fresh again, that's 100% water change, and then changed the decor, toss them back in, they get into breeding behavior. A lot of the times with a lot of fish, that triggers breeding. Of course, diet, water temperature, the season, barometric pressure, a lot of things can also contribute to triggering fish to spawn. But when it comes to fish that are clearly in breeding size, sometimes a change in environment is enough. So I have been thinking about doing that with these guys. I'm not entirely interested in breeding, but I do kind of want to do this for you guys just so you can see the entire life cycle of the vieja cichlid. And these guys are just absolutely gorgeous anyways. Also known as the rainbow cichlid, the redhead cichlid. As you can see, the rainbow name is obvious and clear. But you can also see the differences in male to female. The female, of course, has a flattened nape, where the male is kind of almost has a nuchal hump. And they actually develop a bit of a nuchal hump with age and proper diet, but these guys are absolutely gorgeous. This here is the dominant male, definitely the biggest, but I prefer this one over this guy. I'm not sure why, I think he's just more vibrant colors, but as you can see, he is the dominant guy, kind of chasing him away. And then of course the female. Now notice that nobody has torn fins, nobody's damaged. Of course there's light chasing and whatnot, but this is an okay balanced tank. I might have to remove this guy and just deal with these two, but that's something we'll deal with in the near future. As for the planted aquarium, I know many of you guys are curious about this tank. Mind you, I haven't done any maintenance on any one of these aquariums in a week. So you will notice that some of these aquariums have algae. Some of them need a gravel vacuuming. Some of them need a water change, etc., etc., etc. Believe it or not, I have to go through all the same things you guys go through, and I don't care if my tanks look perfect. I care what they look like in the moment, because that is what we share on this channel, is my aquariums and my experiences and my thoughts and ideas and even education in the moment. These guys are looking absolutely incredible. When the lights go out, these cardinal tetras look absolutely fantastic. Now, I haven't looked in this tank since I've been back for any bodies or anything like that to see if any of them passed, but definitely none. The same amount of cardinals that were in it the first are still in there. And this is just a gorgeous tank. I will say the grass has a bit of algae on the tips, if we can get the camera to look at it properly. And it's just time for me to do a trimming. This tank also still has no CO2. It hasn't had CO2 for well over a month. The plants are not, the grass isn't looking incredibly lush, but I guess if I were to add in some supplements into this tank, I can get it to bounce back. No problem, but I think what I might do here in the coming weeks is add the CO2 back in, Although I don't mind it as is. Very low maintenance. All I do is feed this tank and I do a 50% water change once a week. That's it. I don't even dose. I don't do anything just because the substrate's so nutritious. So the Waru, these guys, I'm gonna change the lighting here. Timmy, everybody ever always asks about Timmy if he's Timmy's my stunted Waru. He doesn't have classic signs of stunting. He has a pretty good body form. His eyes aren't necessarily that big in comparison to his body, but it's just a stunted Waru that never grew. He came from all the same other guys, which are all doing quite fine, including the largest one right here. See if I can get a better angle of him. Yeah, but the Waru tank is doing absolutely fantastic. And I hope that we do get some breeding activity out of that. This is eggshells, nerite snail shells on the glass here. A lot of people ask me what that is. I just don't bother scraping them off. Others wonder what these dots are on the actual fish. Like, he's got some on his gills. This guy doesn't have any. He's got some on his pectoral fin. He's got a big one on his pectoral fin. He's got one on the base near his anal fin. This is just natural coloring in some strains of some localities of Waru. I do find that it is not a common occurrence in wild caught Waru. This is a trait that is more common in captive bred. I think I said that right. So you don't see this in wild Waru, just in captive bred. And I've owned both types. Okay, Tyrese, bro, can we come out? Let me shut this light off here. He doesn't like a ton of commotion near his tank. Do you guys see him? I see him. There he is, over in the glare. What's up, bro? There you go. So this guy, it's probably doubled in size since we got him. He's a big eater too. He'll eat a full clam a couple times a day if I feed him. I have only been giving him one clam. His tank is going to go, his new tank is going to go in the other room here shortly. Temporary setup, we've already mentioned that. So ideally, sooner or later, this tank's going to be freed up and that tank on the end's going to be freed up. And then this like holding tank that we're getting to next is going to be freed up. So we're going to have three tanks empty plus another one set up out there. Plus another one set up right here. So lots of tanks to come. There's not a whole lot to update in here. The Beischer's doing okay. This guy might end up in the 2000 here shortly. You guys will remember that I had a ton of clown loaches. There's only one in this tank visible. There's not one in there. They all go up into this tube. And when I feed them, a rush of them comes squirting out. It's hilarious. I'll have to do a video on that eventually. The last tank of Eco Aquarium. These guys are doing relatively well as well. Notoriously slow growers for the Compriceps, though. And the Julies are doing well. Why won't this focus? I'm so sorry, guys. I'm not very good at camera work. But these guys are doing absolutely fantastic. We do have all of the Simulus shell dwellers in here as well. Oh, these aren't so Simulus. They are Multifasciatus. I don't see any fry yet, but I doubt we will because there's too many predators in this tank that will probably gobble them up. But as you can see, we might add in those other tank, Lake Tanganyika fish into here temporarily, see how everybody gets along, grow them all out, see what happens. But a lot of the times with these types of setups where there's a ton of different species of fish, is it's like almost the more the merrier. Nobody can actually be targeted. And as long as I stay up on top of water quality, it'll work out, no problem. I think I'll just take some shells and I'll add more to over here and fill this out. But again, I'm not sold on that idea, but we'll see what happens. The 2000, oh Lord, Susan. Look how big Susan's getting. Again, it's gonna be difficult to see. I have an Asian arowana up here too. That's one of the blood reds. All the rays are doing fine. I think with this tank, I might be adding in another piece of wood. Many of you guys say, hey, where's all the Asian arowana? Well, that's part of a four-part series that I'm working on. It should be out shortly. You guys are gonna love that. It's absolutely fascinating to see. Now for the topic of the video, the title, the thumbnail, all talking about the king of DIY quit YouTube. Did Joey quit YouTube? I'm not gonna make videos anymore, etc., etc. You know, this might even be my last video. None of that is actually true. This is something that whenever I miss videos for a week or two, a lot of people become concerned, and I gotta say how good that actually feels. One part of me feels frustrated and feels like, guys, I've been making videos for 11 years, over 11 years for you guys. All of a sudden, I'm gonna quit with no notice? Absolutely not. The other side of me is like, man, it feels really good to have people in surplus amounts to actually care about what you're doing because they haven't heard from you in a few days. With that said, it hasn't been a few days, it's been 3 weeks. What have I been up to? Why have I been making videos? I gotta admit, I've just been distracted with personal life. You guys know outside of YouTube, I've got kids, a family, etc. But besides that, I've gone to Aquashella this past weekend. I had to write a talk for that, or at least update it, then do my talk. I'm going to actually, and I know you guys wanna see what's behind that door. You can't, because what's behind there is exactly what I wanted, exactly how I would say it be, and it's been up and running but nobody guessed what happened for over a month. That's why this four-part series is going to take some time. I don't wanna be able to set it up and be like, see, it works. I wanted to have at least a month of footage showing. See, that's coming out shortly. You guys are gonna love it. It's a four-part series, but it's an intense four-part series. The first video is going to be, that's a tough one to make. We'll get to that in another one. Second one is incredibly interesting, but not going to be, if you're part of the membership of this channel, you've got a peek, behind the scenes peek, it's not going to be, it's viewer discretion advised. Part three, part four are just absolutely incredible. I can't wait to show you guys that, but that's something that I've been working on video wise. Okay, so I brought all of my video equipment, or at least cameras, to go film at Aquashella. There's a ton of things. Once I got there, as soon as I got there, I jumped George and Sean from Fritz, as well as George from Coralfish 12G, picked me up from the airport. And they're like, look, we're gonna go make a video with this younger guy. He loves you. You guys gotta check out that video. It's absolutely hilarious. It's phenomenal. A lot of people are like, Joey's so different in this video. And other people are like, no, that's who Joey is on Instagram. Because of course, my persona on Instagram is more lined up with who I am. And on YouTube, we have to stay family friendly. Well, there's certain things and certain jokes and certain ways I can't talk. But so this is just the censored Joey versus Instagram is like, the normal Joey, and I think you guys will enjoy that video. It's absolutely hilarious. I'm gonna leave a link in the description below. So yeah, I have been making videos, just not for my channel. Then of course I did my talk, and my talk was the only thing I actually got content from. I took a selfie with the crowd, and that was it. That was a great talk. A lot of people enjoyed it. I liked it to an extent, although it was ill-prepared and I never had time to practice it per se. I only like doing talks that only last 25 to 35 minutes. I see no reason for me to stand there and talk for an hour. I've gone to hour-long talks, and by the end you're like, oh, thankfully that's over. So I mean, regardless of how much you have to talk about or what importance or how incredibly interesting it is, I think an hour is just way too long. And then I have something really interesting I want to talk about that you guys, when I met many of you, were saying. Before we get into that, I also did the scape off with Dustin, which was on Sunday. And Sunday is the worst time for me to do anything because, of course, on Saturday, I'm hanging out with a lot of you guys at night, and we may or may not be doing drinking adult things. And Sunday morning came, and I probably should have been still sleeping, showed up to the scape off with Dustin, my head's cloudy. It was still fun. Tank Tested actually filmed everything, so I'll use a couple of his clips and I'll leave the link in the description below so you can go check it out. But ultimately, I've done a bunch of scape offs before, undefeated. I'm not a scaper, I've said it a million times. It's just to kind of promote the other YouTubers, promote the scaping hobby, and get people to have a fun time doing these types of things. But I got to admit, scaping off at Dustin, I lost, and I couldn't have lost to a better person. He's been making videos just for as long as me and never truly gets a tremendous amount of attention, even though we've been friends for a long time. So it was great to pass it on to him. And finally, this is the best part. So a lot of when I do these skate offs, you're like, oh, it's just a popularity contest. Oh, it's blah, 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 blah. Like, these are cop-outs. Dustin won. I'm 10 times more popular than him on the internet, and he won fair and square, deserved it, and I was so happy to lose. I'm like, thank you. Now we can actually, here's the fun part. Now, Dustin, you and me can go back to back, do a rematch, and we now know that this is based off the best scape and it is not a popularity contest. I love it. Now the rematch is gonna be even better, more hype, and ultimately, I don't care if I win or lose, I just love to be a part of that sort of thing. And many of you guys love it as well. So if you wanna check that out, go check it out. Link is in the description. Alex makes he's one of my favorite aquarium YouTubers, so while you're there, subscribe. And subscribe to George, because he's just making this ridiculous types of videos. Both are what I remember YouTube used to be like, where there was unique channels and great creators, and unfortunately a lot of things are all the same. You don't even know who you're watching anymore, because we're all making like the same kind of content. Met tons of you guys. Here's a fun thing. I plan to film, I plan to take video, I plan to... ultimately, I know when I'm going to these places, I don't care what happens, I'm there to meet you guys. There to hang out, there to have a good time. And so we take as many photos, sign as many things, whatever you guys want from me. And it's just like in and out, in and out, in and out. Most people just say, love your videos, thanks for what you do. The million subscriber video that I did on how the aquarium hobby saved my life, you guys have no idea how many people that's impacted. That's the number one thank you that I get. And I knew it. I knew I wasn't the only one. I knew that the hobby does a lot for a lot of people. But the number one video request that I was getting, and I got it over and over and over again, or at least the one that I stuck to my head, was like, Joey, can you make product reviews like you do on Instagram? And they don't mean like I don't do product reviews over there. It's just like, keep it real with the product reviews. And I have two questions for you guys. One, the popularity of this channel, or at least the influence, and that sounds arrogant or whatever, but let's be honest. I mean, if I talk negatively about something, we could truly hurt that company. And maybe that's just my experience. So when it comes to reviews and whatnot, I tend to only want to do things and review things that I actually like and use and believe in, because I'm not doing any harm. But I gotta tell you, there's tons of things that I don't like. So it's kind of gonna have to come down to the main audience. What do you guys think about that? Should I do that, or should I just leave it alone? Maybe we do that sort of thing on Instagram. If you're not following me there, go ahead. Link's always in the description. I know that I don't promote my stuff enough. I know that I don't talk about my book that I wrote or my merch or anything like that. I guess I kind of just did, but links are always in the description. Let me know what your ideas and thoughts are on that. It was really interesting to see what you guys wanted me to make for videos. I know for when I'm on the internet, there's an insurmountable amount of comments, questions. And some people get mad at me, like, Joey doesn't answer his fans, or Joey doesn't reply to anybody. And I gotta say, I do. I spend hours and hours every day. I think I spend about 30 to 40 hours a week just replying to comments, messages, sending back videos, et cetera, et cetera. And it's just insurmountable. There's no way I can get to anybody or even chip away at that. And because of that, it makes it look like I'm not doing anything. And it's so hurtful, because I put in so much time to replying to as many as I can. Just have some notes here that I'm trying to... That was pretty much it. Taking time off of YouTube, or taking a break off YouTube, or being a human is definitely detrimental to a YouTuber. If I stop making videos for 2 or 3 weeks, then I make a video. If it is not an explosive video, then YouTube punishes me for like 2-3 months where it's not going to show or email or recommend my video, etc. So excuse the thumbnail and title, but I pretty much have no choice, and it goes well with this video where many people were thinking that I quit YouTube anyway. So it is what it is. Hope you enjoyed today's video. I'm gonna do a few little light videos before we jump into that 4-part series, which is pretty heavy. If you have any comments, suggestions, anything like that, let me know in the comment section below. Also, I got some really difficult to film with this guy sitting there watching me. But I got some really interesting different new foods that I want to feed these guys. So if you want that feeding video, let me know as well in the comment section below. I'll see you guys in the next video. In the meantime, follow me on Instagram, always active on there. Okay, one last thing before I let you guys go. It just came to my head. I wish I would have filmed and documented the entire weekend for you guys. It just wasn't time for me to grab the camera and start filming things. It was impossible for me to move 2 feet and my whole focus, and I didn't want you guys to think I didn't want to meet. Anyways, there was fish keepers there, and they would bring their significant others. One of the things that kept killing me was some of like the wives or husbands would say, it's your fault that, you know, this person has X amount of aquariums, etc., etc. But the funniest thing that kept getting said was, I forget their names. One couple, the wife, I believe it was, said, now whenever my husband looks at his fish or sees a new fish, he describes it like you, where it's, and I know I say it, I'm like, he's like, oh, this fish is absolutely phenomenal. This is absolutely gorgeous. This tank is absolutely fantastic, and I love it. Keep it up. If you guys have any other stories like that, or you get made fun of by your significant other, and it's my fault, let me know in the comment section below. I love that stuff.